class 8th, welcome to English lecture. Today I am going to explain you from your textbook, that is Prime English, chapter 3, A Question of Grammar, which was written by Richmal Crompton. Students, before I start the chapter, I would like to introduce you about the author who has written this story, Richmal Crompton. She was an extremely successful writer of her times, is now almost unknown. Trained to become a teacher, she took up writing as her profession. At the age of 27, she has written more than 40 novels and numerous short stories for both children and adults. Her Just William series was much appreciated for its innovativeness and lack of sentimentality. Yes, student, this is she belongs to a humorous short stories and to a lesser extent adult fiction books also. Richmal Crompton is the second child of the Rev. Edward John Sewell. Richmal Crompton attended self-expense boarding school. She never married and had no children, although she was an aunt and great aunt to other members of her family. Now, Crompton's best known books are the William stories, about a mischievous 11 years old boy and his band of friends known as the Outlaws. Her first short story featuring William to the published was Rice Mold Pudding, published in Home Magazine in 1919. The Outlaws in 1970. She has written this but had not published until later on. In 1922, the first collection entitled Just Williams was published. She wrote 38 other William books throughout her life. The last William, The Lawless, was published by in 1970. The William books sold over 12 million copies in UK alone. They have been adapted for films, stage plays and numerous radio and television series. Illustrations by Thomas Henry contributed to their success. Now, student, this is a little gist about the author. Let's start with the chapter, A Question of Grammar. Student, imagine you have planned a party at your house. You have invited all your friends and made all the arrangements. However, you find out that your parents have to go out and won't be around during the party. So your party is going to be unsupervised. So same happened in this story also. And this is a particular situation which I have given you. Now just imagine if you have arranged a party and definitely the adult and the senior one will only supervise the party when you organize a birthday party or anything at your home. So same happened with this boy. He has arranged a party, but due to last fraction of time, his parents were not available for the supervision. And then what had happened in the story, we'll continue, we'll read the chapter and then we'll came to know that how did he manage and how he has arranged the party elements. So let's read the first paragraph. It was raining. It had been raining all morning. William was intensely bored with his family. Now, since it was raining since morning and it was raining heavily, now William was getting bored with his family. Now he's asking, what can I do? He demanded of his father for the 10th time. Means for the whole day he's asking, you know, like you all do in your home when you are sitting, especially during the lockdown time, you must be feeling bored. If you are, you know, having a extra time, then you keep on asking from your parents, either your father, mother, what can I do? What should I do? So this is the same happening with this boy. Now he's asking 10th time from his father, what can I do? Nothing, said his father fiercely from behind his newspaper. Now William followed his mother into the kitchen. Now when he went to the father, he asked, what should I do? So he replied, nothing, in a very, you know, in a very fierce, in a very dreadful reaction. Then he went immediately to kitchen and again he asked the same question from his mother. What can I do? He said plaintively. Now, plaintively means sadly. Now, in a very sad mood, he asked the same question to his mother. Mother, what should I do? Couldn't you just sit quietly? Suggested his mother. Now, she is saying, can you sit quietly? That's not doing anything, William said. I could sit quietly all day, he went on aggressively, if I wanted to. But you never do, no. Because there wouldn't be any sense in it, wouldn't there? Couldn't you read or draw or something? Now he's asking, mother, what should I do? Now she's saying that you can utilize your time by doing some fruitful activity, do something creative, utilize that time. But now he's saying that what should I do while sitting? You know, the all type of excuses we make with our parents. So same, this boy is also doing. Now student, why did William give his mom a crushing glance? Okay, let's read the chapter. Then you'll get to know that what kind of, you know, mind thoughts are coming in his mind. He went to the drawing room where his sister Ethel was knitting a jumper and talking to a friend. What are you doing, William? Said the friend sweetly. Nothing, said William with a scowl. Now student, the meaning of scowl is, now student, scowl means in a very angry or in a very weird look, he has replied nothing. Nothing means he just wanted to do something, but because he is feeling bored, so he replied nothing in a very scowl reaction. Shut the door when you go out, won't you, William? Said Ethel equally sweetly. William rose with dignity at that insult and went to the door. At the door he turned. I won't stay here now, he said with slow contempt. Not even if, even if, even if. He paused to consider the most remote contingency. Contingency student mean an even that is possible in future but is not certain. Not even if you wanted me, he said at last emphatically. Emphatically means forcefully. Now forcefully is saying that I don't want to say stay over there, and actually he's not able to adjust that insult that his sister said that okay, if you are having nothing, please go out. So he found it very insulting, you know, insulting kind of reaction. So he went out immediately from that room. He shut the door behind him and his expression relaxed into a sardonic smile. Sardonic means mocking smile. I bet they feel small, he said to the umbrella stand. He went to the library where his 17-year-old brother Robert was showing off his new rifle to a friend. Now when he went to his sister's room, then he find that she is busy with her friend and doing something, and she is knitting and doing something. Then he went to another room, that is a library part, and he found that his brother, who is approximately 17 years old, his name is Robert, and he is showing rifle to a friend. Now in this page you'll come to know, you see, he was saying, then catching sight of William's face round the door, oh, get out. William got out. Now again he said, asked William to please go out. Now student, why do you think nobody wants to spend time with William? Not even his parents, not even his sister, now not even his brother Robert also. He returned to his mother in the kitchen with a still more jaundiced. Jaundiced means bitter. Okay, it is you know, a very harsh, in a very jaundiced. Jaundiced means you know, kind of bitter attitude. Yeah, view of life. It was still raining. Now rain is continuing, and his mother was looking at the tradesman books. Can I go out? He said gloomily. And no, of course not, it's pouring. Now she said no, it's still pouring, and she's waiting for some tradesman book, some sailor of books, and she's wanting that book, and she's waiting for that particular person. Now again William came to her mother and asked, mother, can I go out? She said no, of course not, still it's raining. I don't mind rain, don't be silly. Now he said that I don't mind, can I go out? She said no, don't be silly. William considered that few boys in the whole world were handicapped by more unsympathetic parents than he. why he said pathetically they have got friends in Anne and me not. It is because, you know, he thought his mind is, you know, it's a child mind student. So he's thinking that his parents are overruling him, over commanding him, and it is raining. For him, it is not a big issue. But for parents, it's a big issue. Why? Because when he'll, you know, when he'll go out, then still rain is going, and he will, you know, pour himself and become wet. And when he'll come back to home, then he must be suffering from fever. So all these consequences and symptoms, their parents must be knowing. So that is why they are not allowing him to go. But because William is having a little baby and little child in his mind, so he wanted to go out and spend his time with friends or play something. And this is all he wants. So that is why he said that, pathetically, they have got friends in Anne and me not. Means everyone is having friends, but I am not having friends. So everyone is busy, even his brother, mother, brother, sister, all are busy with their friends and doing something. But he is so pathetic in situation that he is not having even a single friend who can spend time with him. "I suppose you didn't think of asking anyone," she said calmly. "Well, can I have someone now?" "No, it's too late," said Mrs. Brown, raising her head from the butcher's book. Now, I told you that again she asked from Mrs. Brown that can I have someone now? And then she said, "No, it's too late." And she is very, you know, she is counting in her mind 10 and 11 pence. And again he came and disturbing her. Now she raised a harassed face. "William, do be quiet anytime if you ask 18 and 2 pence." Now she's counting something and he is disturbing her. So she said that, "Please go to your father and ask these questions from your father." Now William went out. He returned to the dining room where his father was still reading a paper. The sigh with which his father greeted his entrance was not one of relief. "If you have come to ask question," now his father knows that again he's coming to ask some question, you know, as we all do in our home. In the same way, again and again he's coming and he's going some time to his mother, brother, sister. And now he's coming to his father and asking same question again. That, but before he asked the question, father has, you know, warned him before while only that if you have come to ask question, he began threateningly. Now in a very tired and in a very anger way, he said, "Again, you have come to ask any question?" "I haven't," said William quickly. Now he said, "No, father, I didn't came to ask any question." "Now, Feather, when you are away on Saturday, can I have a party?" Now, William asked very politely to his father that on Saturday when you all are going, can I have a party? "No, of course not," said his father irritably. "Can't you do something?" Now he said that, "No, I'm not allowing you for the party. And do something, some work. Do not disturb and come again and again and asking the different types of questions. The sort of things I want to do, they don't want me to do. A sort of things I don't want to do, they want me to do," mother said to Ned. His scorn and fury were indescribable. His father looked out of the window. "Thank heaven, it stopped raining. Go out." William went out. Now, what he's doing, he's asking that, can I have a party and can I throw a party on Saturday? He said no. Now, what he's thinking in his mind, he's thinking that whatever I want to do, they are saying no. And what I don't want to do, they are suggesting me to do that work only. Now, his mother said, "Why don't you do knitting?" So, he doesn't want to do knit also because he's a child and he's not interested in knitting. Now, all of a sudden, when father, you know, looking out of the window, he saw that it is almost stopped raining. And so he asked William to go out and have fun. Now, what do you think William would do after going out, student? What do you think? Actually, he's waiting since morning to go out. Now, what do you think when he'll go out and what the first thing he'll do? He came home wet and dirty and cheerful, as it is very normal with all the child. They go out and they, you know, they are wet and they, you know, they just spoil their dress and that particular thing they like a lot, and they have, and he is like other children, he is also very cheerful and happy while doing all that thing. He approached his father warmly. "Did you say I could have a party, father?" he said casually. Now again he is trying to, you know, trying to talk to his father. Now he is again asking the question, "Did you say I could have a party?" "No, I did not," said Mr. Brown firmly. "William, let the matter rest for the present." Now again he is asking in a very polite way that, "Father, are you allowing me to have a party?" And he said, "No, I am not allowing you for the party." And now he thought that it's better do not ask the same question in a present time. He spent most of the English grammar class in school. Next morning, considering it, there was a great deal to be. Let's come to the next page, student. Set for a party to the absence of one's parent and growing brother, grown-up brother and sister, he would like to ask George and Ginger and Henry and Douglas and heaps of them. He would like to ask them all. They were the whole class 30 number. Now he's asking for a party, for the, you know, he's thinking that his parent is going to be out, and so he is, you know, he's trying to contact with all his friends, George, Ginger, Henry. It is approximately 30 student in his class, and he's talking to all of them. "What have I just been saying, William?" William signed, "Was it anything about participles?" He remembered something vaguely about participle, but it might not have been today. Now, actually, teacher is teaching and he is busy in talking with his friends. So she immediately asked from William, "Can you see in the picture that teacher is asking from William that, do you remember what I'm teaching and what am I teaching?" Now he's talking about the participle. Now he thought that she's talking about the participle, but she's not talking about the participle. He remembered something vaguely about participle, but it might not have been today. But she's not talking participle today. "Miss Jones groaned. That was ever so long ago, William," she said. "You have not been attending." Now she said that I have taught you about participles long ago, and now I'm not teaching participle, and you are not concentrating on class, and you are too busy in talking with your friends. William cleared his throat with a certain dignity and made no answer. Now he is trying to, you know, trying to rescue himself, and he is trying to show his himself in a very, you know, very polite and innocent, like a child in front of his teacher. He cleared his throat and tell him, Henry stopped his fascinating occupation of trying to push a fly into his inkwell with his nib and answered mechanically, "Two negatives makes an affirmative," means two, in a physics we say 2 minus makes a positive. "Yes, say that, William." William repeated it without betraying any great interest in the fact. "Yes, what's a negative, William?" William signed, "Something about photographs," he said obliquely. Obliquely means, student, obliquely means something in a, you know, obliquely means in a very authorized way, or something is indebted in a polite way. So he said the same thing, and in a very polite way, and something about the photograph, he said. And the teacher replied, "No," snapped Miss Jones. She found William and the heat rather trying. They are actually trying. They are not able to give the actual answer. So it's no and not. Now teacher said it's no and not. And an affirmative is yes. Now she's explaining. Now immediately he replied, "Oh," said William. Now he's giving a sarcastic reply, "Oh." So she said that means two no's and nots mean yes. If they are in the same sentence, if you said there is not no money in the box, you mean there is. Means if you say no two times in a sentence, it means yes. So she said, she's explaining that two no means it is yes. Now William considered that and he said, "Oh," again. Then he seemed suddenly to become intelligent, and he found himself to be very intelligent. Then he said, if you say no and not in the same sentence, does it mean yes? Certainly. Now William smiled. Now, you know, certainly means she said yes, almost. Now he's asking the same question from his teacher. Reply back means, teacher, if somebody say no and not in the same sentence, then does it mean yes? Now she said certainly. Certainly means possibility, maybe, might be. William smiled. Now William's smile was a rare thing. Why do you think William smiled, student? I know. You must be knowing the answer. William smiled because now he is relating his sentence with his father. He said no to the party. You remember? He said no two times. Now he is calculating that incident with the present situation and is comparing both the sentence. Okay, let's go further. Miss Jones was quite touched. It's all right, William, she said. I'm glad you are beginning to take an interest in your work. Now she is saying that she is happy, at least now you are taking interest in your work. William was murmuring to himself. Now William is talking to himself. No, of course not. No, of course not means no, I did not. And a no on a not mean a yes. So he meant yes, of course, and yes, I did. Now he's, miscalculating the no, not, never, yes. He's just calculating all these words in a same sentence. He waited till Friday before he gave his friend his invitation with a casual air. He's actually waiting till Friday for the invitation. Now, student, he's trying to invite his friends in this paragraph. Can you see that he has written, my folk is going away tomorrow and they said I could have a few friends into tea. Can you come tell your mother? They said just to come and not bother to write. He was born strategist. Strategist means someone who is good in planning, especially in war or politics. Now he's trying to invite his friends and he's calling up them for the tea and have a little party also. Now he has already planned all the things and he's invited all his friends. Now William mother, now that it's a Saturday morning, it's a very fresh day. Now, student, I would like to ask you one question. Why do you think all his friends accepted William's invitation? Yes, of course, because they all wanted to come to his home and enjoy the party and spend time with William. So they all have accepted William's invitation and all are ready to come. Now it's Saturday morning and William's mother was took an anxious farewell of him and she has already explained each and everything to William and his sister Jane that what they have to do and how they have to have a dinner, lunch, and how they'll complete their all work. It's not dinner, it's about lunch. You won't do anything. We have told you not to, will you? Now she is, reminding William that you don't have to do anything and she has not given any permission for anything to do. So she's reminding all these rules and regulations before leaving the home. Now very politely and calmly he said, no mother, only things you have said yes to. Only thing which you have said yes, I'll do that only. Now cook and Jane had a long look forward to this day. There would be a little to do in the house. Now there was not such work to do. So there was not much work over there. So they are just planning what they have to do, how they have to spend the time. Now what Jane was thinking, she decided to go out with her friends. Now it's approximately 3 o'clock. The postman came. And the cook, she went to take the letter, and when she was taking the letter, she stood gazing down the road as through. Can you see the last line? They have written it was gazing down the road. It's as through transfixed. Transfixed student not being able to move due to horror or shock means she was almost stuck and. She is almost shocked to see that that cook went to took up the letter and opened the door. She found that, let's come to the next slide, then you'll come to know what happened, why she has given this reaction, why she was shocked. Now William had collected his guest and Ruth, she was bringing them joyfully. Now in a very happy mood, he is welcoming his friends and they dropped in at the garden gate. Cook cook was pale and speechless and watched them and then she speechless departed. Now she's asking William, why you are not coming in here? You should not supposed to come along with so many friends. Those boys cluttering up the garden for. They have now. He said no. They are coming for the tea, and now again she has become paler, and she's shocked, and she's speechless that they have not. She said fiercely, "What your father had said? Do you remember that?" He said that they could come, said William. Now William is saying that father has already given me the permission, and he said that they could come. I asked him and he said yes, of course. And I asked him if he would said no. He said yes. Now student, do you remember that the class which he has taken yes or no one? Now he is contrasting that yes and no in this particular situation. That's what he said. Because of English grammar, what Miss Jones said, Cook's answer was to slam the door in his face and lock it. The 30 guests were slightly disconcerted. Disconcerted means unsettled, but not for long. "Come on," shouted William excitedly. Now William is in a very happy and cheerful mood. Now he said, "Come on, she's the enemy." Now he is, he's just blaming that she's the enemy. Now he's saying that Cook is the enemy. "Let's storm her old castle." The guest spirit rose. This promised to be infinitely superior to the usual party. Now, can you understanding the thought of William? Now, as we are continuing with the chapter, we are understanding that he is strategically planning his party by his own memory and thought without taking actual permission from anybody. Now, again, he is trying to disturb home. Now she said, the cook said that I won't allow you to come inside with so many of people, and they will only spoil home decoration, and although your parents have not allowed for the party, how you have called them, but he simply called her an enemy. Now he started throwing stone on window because he wanted to get inside, and then all this happening, they are just disturbing the floor, they are disturbing the garden, they are throwing stone, they are coming inside with the muddy footwear, and when they immediately when they enter the house, the party has been started. Now can you see? Now student, I would like to ask you, do you think that this was the right way of having fun? The author was asking this question from you all also. It fulfilled the expectation of the guests that it was to be party and like other. Now it fulfilled the expectation of party. He wanted to do a party. Now he's doing a party. But is this the right way to do the party? You're disturbing your home decoration. You're disturbing your, without taking permission from your parents. You're enjoying the party. Now stairs down the stairs in all the bedrooms, sliding down from the stairs, and drawing room leaving trace of muddy boots and shattered ornaments as they went. It was William who discovered first that it was tea time and there was no tea. At first he felt slightly aggrieved, then he thought of the larder and his spirit rose. "Come on," he called, "all just get what you can." They trooped in panting, shouting, laughing, and all just go what they could. Now everyone is doing their own, whatever they want, even his friends also. Now Ginger seized the remains of a cold ham and picked the bone. George with great gusto drank a whole jar of cream. William and Douglas ate a gooseberry pie between them. Henry ate a whole currant cake. Each forage means a search for food for himself. They ate two bowls of cold vegetables, a joint of meat, two pots of honey, 3 dozen oranges, 3 loaves and 2 gallons of grape juice. They left the larder a place of gaping emptiness. Meanwhile, Cook's voice growing horror means she is getting more loud, and she knows what was the outcome of that party, and she knows the result also. And hoarser as the result of the inhalation of coal dust and exhalation of imprecations. Imprecations means spoken curses. Still arose from the depth, and still the door of the coal cellar shook and rattled. Then one of the guests who had been in the drawing room window came back. "She's coming home," he shouted excitedly. They flocked to the window. Jane was bidding a fond farewell to her young man at the side gate. Now she is giving a wave, Jane went to his friend for the enjoyment to spend a good day. Now everybody is looking at the window and they are saying that she's coming, means Jane is coming. Don't let her come in, yelled William. William shouted, you know, in a very loud way, and he said, don't let her come inside, otherwise we all will you know, get in a mess. Don't let her come in. And now, student, why do you think the kids didn't want Jane to come in? Of course, she's a elder sister and they don't want that their party should get blocked. So that is why maybe this would be the reason. With a smile of blissful reminiscence upon her face, Jane turned in at the gate. Now, reminiscence means recollection of something happy. Now, she is very happy and very happily she is coming inside the home. So, this is, we are in the last paragraph, and at last, I would like to conclude the chapter. Totally unprepared for being met by a shower of missiles from the upper windows, a lump of lard hit her on the ear and knocked her hat on one side. She retreated hastily to the side gate. Go on, send her into the road. A shower of onions, the ham bone, and a few potatoes persuaded her into the road. Shouts of triumph rent the air, then the shouts of triumph died away abruptly. William's smile also faded away, and his hand, in the act of flinging an opinion, dropped. A cab was turning in at the front gate. In the sudden silence that fell upon the party, cook horse cries for vengeance, revenge rose with redoubled means stronger force from the coal cellar. William grew pale. The cab contained his family. Now he's planning that his sister should not get inside, so he's planning all the things to stop her coming inside. But he was trying all the method he could do, but soon he realized that now cook is already very angry from him. She saw that a cab is also coming. In that cab, his whole family is over there. Now William grew pale. Obviously, he's pale because he knows that he has created the home messy, and he has spoiled the atmosphere. He has spoiled the decoration of the home, and this made William quite pale also. And well, there is nothing to be short because cook knows that this is only the outcome and result of this party. Now, student, I hope you have understood that how naughty and a planner William was, and he planned a party without taking actual permission from his parents. This is a story of William's willful misunderstanding of a double negative leads, which throw him to a wild party in his parents' absence. Because of the double misunderstanding, he thought that they are giving him a permission, and so he invited all his friends. And this story has been taken from Just William. Just William is the first book of children's short stories about the young school boy William Brown, which was written by Richmal Crompton and published in 1922. This book was the first series in the William Brown books, which was the basis for numerous television series. Just William is also sometimes used as a title for the series of books as a whole, and is also the name of various television. Now, Just William is a book, student, where number of short stories have been mentioned. And so this is the chapter 6 of Just William, Question of Grammar. The William short story first appeared in Home Magazine and Happy Magazine. I hope you have understood with the chapter, and I have given you few questions also. Please try to find out the answer of those questions which I have asked you in the middle of the chapter. And on my next video, I will give you the question answers of all the chapter which I have told you on my video. But before that, I would like that you should read this chapter thoroughly and try to find out the answer by your own, and then match those answers with my answers when I will upload another video of question and answers. Thank you and have a good day.